When software breaks, who do we blame? Users? Programmers? Hardware? There are thousands of ways that your favorite software breaks. In today's video, I'm going to go over some common ways that software breaks and what we can do to fix it. Let's get started. The new update for Ladoo has finally dropped, version 2.0. So John decided to upgrade to the latest version and give it a try. So many dropdowns, buttons, features, whatever. Let's import all of our existing data from another software. What? When it comes to broken software, a user error is extremely common. I mean, at least that's what developers claim is the reason. In the broad sense of everything, user error relies on when any human is the cause of any error, whether this user is trying to use an application normally as a customer or a person working on the system that knows what they're doing. Arguably, this is where the job of a programmer becomes the hardest, managing how a human being interacts with their software. Over 88% of data breaches actually come from human beings tricked or not following protocols. Sometimes this can lead to mildly annoying bugs like issues in a navigation bar, all the way to accidentally creating an infinite loop that sends an HTTP request to your server. Multiply this by 20 people and your server either gets an accidental DDoS attack or you accidentally blacklisted your own users. Fixing user errors is notoriously tough, and realistically, it's never fully achievable. But that being said though, there are a handful of different methods that programmers can do to gain more confidence in making sure that they can deploy successfully. Error handling. So obviously, but being much more thorough in your error handling. If a user fills out a form and clicks a button, then maybe tell them what is wrong in a form. Or if you get a programming error on the back end, let them know that it's an internal error. This eliminates the whole one error to solve them all. Automated UI testing. In web applications, you can use something like Playwright, which can automate your user interactions in a browser. That way you can automate all the actions a user typically would do in a script that could be run before you commit your code or before submitting a pull request. And for desktop applications, you can use something like Robot Framework, etc. And let's be real here, the best way to find human issues is to actually have a human find them. Somewhere in the process, having a group of users test out the software before going live is one of the best ways to really prove that your software is ready. For example, the thing I've noticed a lot is that users love to click things many, many, many times over. So that's a condition I always test for in my web applications. Susan needed to export data on an A/B test in order to validate a feature she wanted to develop. So she picked the correct dates and clicked export, and her Chrome tab got slower and slower until it crashed. Okay, screw it. Let me open up the code and see if I can just call the function directly to avoid this mess. But upon opening, many red flags. Hard-coded variables, unhandled errors, no documentation, no tests. Everything was a mess. Now, when we talk about poor code quality, we often run into areas where, you know, it becomes somewhat subjective. It's important to realize though that users look at each individual piece of software as small components that they can interact with independently from its context. So if we create a new function for each button on the application, we now have to fix a bug in 12 different places. If we don't name variables or functions correctly, how can anyone else come in and read any of this? And to the credit of the programmers writing these, usually that's me, this code is often created to fit a very specific use case mixed with tight deadlines and other priorities that they just didn't have time to get to. So when you're building software, you have to maintain it, meaning that a job is never finished. It's just done for today. So here's some solutions. Setting boundaries. So the root cause of poor code quality can be, well, many things. Realistically, no one wants to be a bad programmer. We just default to it under stressful constraints. Setting boundaries to allow yourself more proper implementation is a mental tool you could use. Have a human review your code. If you work in an organization, most likely you're going to be reporting to someone who will have to manually review your code. Or if you're a solo dev, a rubber duck helps too. You can also use tools like trunk code quality to run formatters, linters, and more. This can be integrated in your code editor, a continuous integration pipeline, more on that later, or the command line. This becomes extremely important when you start working with smaller or large teams, as IDEs or operating systems can automatically alter the way code is being handled. Unit testing lets you test your functions by expecting an outcome back from that function. By implementing these in your code base, you can keep developing features without the fear of breaking one thing by accident. After you finish a feature, run the test and see if anything broke. Rinse and repeat. Okay. Should I say it? Okay. Or it's a skill issue. Steve just finished version 2 of the API for the Ludo application, used by thousands of users worldwide. Version 2 introduces much better support for developers to integrate Ludo in their own app. Awesome. Let's deploy. Well, now a sanity check. Let's access the application and try. Oh, crap. Integration issues often happen when the team doesn't take the whole picture into consideration. In this example, a new API version was created, but somehow the front end of the application wasn't receiving this update, meaning we had a completely broken experience. Software projects have many moving parts that all rely on each other. Some of these you can control, like the software that's being run on your servers, while others you can't, like the user's internet connection. In this case here, when the new API was deployed, a lot of the users had the old HTTP request cached, which take a while to invalidate. And there's actually a lot of things that can break that is completely out of our control, but we still rely on it anyway. So what do we do? In order to gain confidence, we need to replicate the existing state of the server hosting the actual application. Depending on how crazy you want to get, you can have as many environments as you want, but usually you would have a staging server that is exactly like your production server to test before doing the big push. The continuous integration and delivery methodology is a set of practices we can use to automate the merge and deployment process. In practice, we would use a pipeline to manage the process of approving pull requests, running tests, using trunk code quality to automatically run things like an OSV scanner, Trivy, Trufflehog, and other security linters. When you're ready for a deployment, gradually roll it out where you can have an easy look into how it's performing before it goes to everybody. So in the case of the API that person ran and screwed up, you would release that on a new endpoint called version 2 and keep the version 1 up so that, you know, if anything bad happens, that could happen. Grace was hired to integrate the OpenAI API into their application. Venture capitalists want AI everywhere. Go figure. When Grace implements her code, she runs the tests and finds that sometimes the AI tests are sometimes green, but sometimes red. Okay, let's open up Slack. The OpenAI tests are inconsistent. What can I do? Okay, don't worry about it. We just ignore those tests anyway. Okay, Grace pushes up the code and has her pull request accepted into the main branch. Grace then opens up Ludo and clicks on the brand new AI feature, but it doesn't work. It only gives errors? What happened? Similar to the integration test, when you have a third-party API that you are not in control of, you have to rely on its uptime or it just being there in order for your application to work. Flaky tests are tests that return a pass or a failure despite nothing changing in the code base. Since it's inconsistent, the team just moves on forward like it doesn't exist. The issue with this is that when we ignore tests like this, we start to deteriorate our trust in the testing system and then just completely do 100%. Flaky tests are complicated, so I partnered with Trunk.io to talk about how you can use the brand new Trunk Flaky Tests to identify these tests and all of the different pull requests that they impact. Trunk will detect which test in your test suite is flaky and provide inline insights right in your pull request so you can understand when and why the test failed, as well as how you can streamline this workflow. These tests often slow down progress and getting new features out, so Trunk will sideline detected flaky tests so that your pull requests can be merged without rerunning your entire build process in your CI. It integrates easily into your existing tools like GitHub Actions, CircleCI, Jenkins, and more. If you're interested in trying out Trunk Flaky Tests, make sure you click the link in the description to learn more and support the channel. Jason joined a company that relies on a 15-year-old system. It just works, apparently. Okay, not going to question, I'm new here. Seeing the dependencies involved, some of these softwares are decades old at the earliest. Whatever. The good news is this new feature is finally finished and is being pushed up to production server for the users. I've worked on it for months. 1 month later, we can't log into our server. In fact, the server is redirecting us to some sketchy server. Oh God, this is bad. Really bad. Remember when I said that software is like maintaining a garden? Well, this is especially true when you're running software that people depend on. As new security vulnerabilities are discovered, maintainers test their software for any risks to let their users know what they should update. Software changes daily, so if you're 10 to 15 years behind, so are all the vulnerabilities that have been patched. Many things can trigger a security incident, perhaps a user error that results in damage to a system or a bad actor looking to cause as much damage as possible. And of course, there are solutions to this. It seems fairly simple, but updating your dependencies. In situations like Jason's, upgrading your dependencies probably requires a complete refactor of your application, considering that's like 10 to 15 years in the past. So what do you even do in these situations then? Technical debt. It's the cost of additional rework later because you do the quick and easy solution now. In order to eliminate this, make sure to document technical debt and include it as part of the work you need to do. Introducing a reduction cycle in your development cycle is a good way to do this. People only care about security when they're the victim of it. There are a ton of ways that software breaks down, but if you want to see more software that breaks down, watch my videos. I built an AI that automates all of my applications, a $10,000 trading bot, as well as AI memes that was trained on over 10,000 different memes. It's pretty stupid, to be honest.